Haven't already, make sure you share that with other people so they can enjoy the message tonight, because we're going to be starting the first part of our series called Activate, and I'm looking forward to it. Now, what we're going to do a little bit different tonight, we will start with prayer, but we're going to wait on all the prayer requests from the online and in person till the end of our service. But we are going to start in prayer where we all join prayer together, and then we'll get to a few songs, then we'll jump right into our message for the night. For those that's watching YouTube, we appreciate y'all. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel, and also those that's Facebook, appreciate y'all, and make sure you like our page. Let's all stand tonight if you would. Good to see everybody out. We are almost done with 2020. Amen?
Yes.
Remember, what we call this year ain't going to make the difference on what it really will be in our hearts. So I know 2020 has been rough. It's been rough on a lot of people that's watching. But every single day, whether it's 2021 or 2020, if it's a day that the Lord has made, then it's a day for us to serve Him. Okay? We make it for its best. There will be one day that sets apart from every other day. I'm sorry, calendar years change, days change, seasons change. There will be one day, and that's the day of the Lord.
That's right.
So you be ready for the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord is the day of His returning. The day that He came to this earth by the means of His mother Mary was also a day of the Lord. But there will come one day of the Lord that will take you off your feet. And that's the one I'm looking forward to. That's the one I want to be preparing the world for. For Jesus Christ to return. So be ready for that day. Could come any moment. Any hour. So praise the Lord for what He's done. Prayer requests we'll have in just a moment after we get done with our study, and then we'll get into that. Let's all bow our heads, okay? Father God, we just thank You for what You've given us. Father, right now I just ask that You just open up our hearts and our minds to Your message. And Father, that You would just bless this service in such a mighty way. Bless the musicians. Bless the singers. And Father, we'll give You the praise and the glory of everything that's done. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. For those that's watching tonight, we give you the opportunity to come get the communion packets. Make sure before you leave, if you're not going to be in service with us for our communion service on Sunday morning, make sure that you come by 10 to 10:30 Sunday morning, which is January the 3rd. We're going to have our communion service this coming Sunday. Some people may have already took that opportunity to do that, but if you didn't, that's fine. If you would, remain standing. Yes, Miss Marge.
I just wondered what people would be thinking if they're out at their loved one's grave and all of a sudden
something starts moving, right?
Yeah.
Right, that's right. What a wide-opening experience that will be. Shelly, if you would come, she's going to join me in song tonight. Brother Brock, if you would come. Let's all sing this song together, and then Shelly has another song, and then we have Miss Linda this coming. Shelly has a song. Good seeing Shelly back, right?
Amen.
Let's give Him thanks tonight for what He's done.
Thank you.
you believe that tonight, you may be seated. I want to thank the deacons for getting together. Miss Linda also, doing a good job of getting our packets out. As I mentioned earlier, for those that didn't hear it, one of the main announcements that we have is make sure you come get your packet for the communion service starting at 10 a.m. to 10:30. We'll have the deacons available to hand those out to our service before the service starts. And before we started our service, we give an opportunity for anybody to come. I don't know if anybody took advantage of that, but hopefully they did. And if they did, they're getting ready for communion service on Sunday. Now, we'll be doing our regular service along with communion service on Sunday. Brother Roger, you got any announcements?
Just a Sunday school worship.
All right, so just a reminder for everybody that's watching, quick comments just from all the teachers. We're looking forward for you being here. We have basically, we've scaled it down because of all the, you know, coronavirus and all that, but we have adult Bible study inside the fellowship hall. The Titus 2 ladies class is still meeting. We have the youth that's still meeting with the teachers. Also, we have a children's class. So make sure you bring your kids and let's get back to what God sees very, very important, which is us learning more about Him. Amen. All right. Other than that, Shelly, if you would come. Listen to the words of this song, and then we're going to end our music portion with Miss Linda in just a portion, in just a moment.
Thank you. Page, if y'all would. Turn mine down just a little bit.
I'll keep it right down here. 177, if y'all would, stand up. This will be our last congregational song. For y'all watching at home, sing it with us. I hope this is part of your testimony. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about Christians who's praying. We're talking about Christians who's saved. And not just saying they're saved. They have been washed in the blood of the Lamb. Amen? So let's sing this together tonight. Let's remember those, so many that's hurt by the coronavirus. So many people that's being lost in our community. So many people hurting right now in our community. Loss of job, all these things. But there is one powerful thing that still stands today, and that's Jesus Christ. Are you washed in the blood? Page 177 in your books.
Happy birthday.
this is sticking around with us, if you would, turn your Bibles this evening to Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5. We're looking at this activate, okay? Now, we're going to get to our more in-depth prayer request at the end of the service. So just hold on to that. But first, we want to jump right into the Word. Make sure we remind everybody. Make sure you share this. And I have to remind everybody that's watching, my intent is not for my content to keep people viewing. Okay? That's not my premise. I'll be honest with you. I've been reading a lot of different blogs and magazines. And here's what they're finding out. Preachers are finding this out, that we have focused way too much on content, not enough on the Word, okay? And the Spirit infiltrating this guy up here so I can just bring you the message that God already had planned, okay? Now, I believe that's how it works. It's not my job as a pastor to worry myself to death with content of how it's going to entertain you for the next 30 minutes. That is not my task. What you need to do is be ready for the message of God once you read the Word of God to be presented and the conviction to come from the Holy Spirit that's already right there in the pew with you. Hopefully, the Holy Spirit's right inside your soul. Okay? Amen?
Amen.
And for those that's watching, the same thing can happen for you. We know that there is a great bit of difference. We know that distance-wise, we don't know how far some people's watching this tonight, but I realize that if you would allow the Holy Spirit to touch you in your seats, in your car, wherever you're watching this, in your homes, the Holy Spirit can bring you to that point of where you truly understand God's Word. You get all that you need out of God's Word. And so I've asked for an extra pouring of the Holy Spirit in the next few weeks and continually for every single member of this church, that we would be filled with the Holy Spirit so that the conviction of God would be on our hearts so people will be changed and transformed. You've heard me insert that magic word for the last week, transformation. That's what we got to do. That's where we're starting at ground level, okay? And when I say ground level, in 2021, right here today, past week, Jonathan has been putting this point that we must start at ground level to begin the great work that Christ has in 2021. Now, I have had put on my heart this study for several months of the study in Acts. And this is transforming in itself just by what God had planned for us to look at some of these main premises of Activate, okay? And we've been studying in Acts for several weeks. We're going to continue our study in Acts, but also bring in some of these important things that is so very important as some examples. Foundational truths in our lives. Individual things that God does. We look at the gospel, being born again, water baptism, the vital ministry of the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, the Lordship of Christ, and growing in God. And what that really means, we're going to be bringing those points out. But now when we reach Acts chapter 5, the last study that we had, we talked about just how the bliss was just beautiful, how the church had come together and they had come together in God's unity and there was nothing that was bad. God was just spreading. The gospel was being blessed. And all of a sudden, at the very beginning of Acts chapter 5, we saw that someone tried to lie to the church. Sin come into the New Testament church. Well, let me tell you something. As I said last week, and I'll repeat this, it's not our job to make sure sin doesn't come into church, because if we was trying to keep sin out of the church, very few of us would be in this church on a normal basis. That's not our job. The song that we sung about the blessed blood of the Lamb is the one that washes those stains clear. It's the one that keeps us in the steadfast hope and blessed gospel of Jesus Christ. And He done all that when we didn't even deserve it. But what we do know is the church needs to realize that it is our emphasis to change people and transform. The only way I can do that as a pastor, to encourage you to do that through the Spirit and the power of God, is for you to lay off the sin and give it to God. Amen. If you go into a church and they never preach on sin, they never preach. And when you hear this preacher preach on sin, I'm going to preach on every sin. You say, well, that's just not good enough. I want you to preach on this, this, and this. don't you preach on drinking? Don't you preach on smoking? Don't you preach on this? You know what? When people start telling me what to preach on, they're probably hiding what they don't want me to preach on.
That's right.
Okay? So here's what I do. Everything that's a sin, and most of you know what it's a sin, and if it's a sin, it ain't about what the preacher's told you, it's what the Holy Spirit has convicted on your hearts already. And if the Holy Spirit don't convict you of that sin, you're just doing what the preacher's told you to do. And that ain't no good anyway. So God wants you to be convicted. And that's part of our study. That's what you're seeing here with the church. Was it bad that there was sin in the church? Of course. And God handled that sin. Ananias and Sapphira met their doom. Now after this, God gave us strict orders. From Matthew chapter 18 to the premise of brotherly love, how we handle discipline inside the church has been given several books in the New Testament how we handle church discipline. The church has reminded its believers, if you love one another, you will rebuke them in a kind and faithful spirit. Those that knows the gospel will help those brothers and sisters out of that sin, out of love. We're never supposed to become the scribes and the Pharisees. So the premise of what we want to sort of sum that portion up is we keep moving as a church. The New Testament church moved on beyond even death in the church and sin in the church. And so must we. Okay? We must move on. I want to admit to you, for all those people who's always had all the great reasons not to come to Plainview Baptist Church, I'm going to talk to you one-on-one. Every good excuse that ever members ever gave you of not coming to Plainview Baptist Church or this church or any other church is not a good enough excuse for you not to know the blessed gospel of Jesus Christ. People will let you down, and they'll continue to let you down. People will put themselves in the place of wanting to sin, which makes them hypocrites. But this church is about turning hypocrites and to those who are following Jesus Christ, I'll promise you that. Every church is going to have their hypocrites. But every church should be changing those hypocrites to the ones they should be. And that's what we want to do here. Acts chapter 5, I've repeated that several times already, ain't I? 17th verse, then the high priest rose up. And all they that were with them, which is the sect of the Sadducees, and were filled with indignation. Oh, they're mad at this point because of what is being preached to them. And laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. But the angel Lord by night opened the prison doors and brought them forth and said, go stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. Now I want you to pause there and look at this important thing. Go and speak in the temple. Now, why was it, you know, we look at that and we're like, okay, they're going back to church. No, this was not their temple, okay? This was the Sadducees' temple. This was the Pharisees' temple. This was the other religious leaders' temple. They was told to go into that religious setting and really preach what religion was. Now, what reason I'm saying this, I want you to see these key words. Go speak into the temple to the people all the words of this life. Are we doing that today? And when they had heard, look at the 21st verse, and when they heard that, they entered into the temple early in the morning and taught. But the high priest came and they were with him and called the council together and all the senate of the children of Israel and sent to the prison to have them brought. But when the officers came and found them not in the prison, they returned and told, saying, the prison truly found we shut with all safety, and the keeper standing without before the doors. But when we had opened, we found no man within. Now when the high priest and the captain of the temple and the chief priest heard these things, they doubted of them whereunto this would grow. Then came one and told them, saying, behold, the men whom ye put in prison are standing in the temple teaching the people. They was looking back at the prison for the very ones they was looking for. They's already in the temple. They's ready to be arrested again. Can't keep good people down, you know, in a way. This is sort of what this is showing us. Now, did they break out of prison? No, I do not believe they broke out of prison. Once again, the angel of the Lord brought them out. so that they could preach the gospel. Because God will let his message be told. I don't care how much coronavirus and how many people's not coming to church and all this. He's going to use this. He's going to use some kind of mode. The gospel will not go out void. God will not allow it. The gates of hell shall not prevail against his church. Amen. Amen. Nothing's going to tear up his church. That's something we need to remember. That's why I wanted to sing especially those songs tonight, because we need to be praising him for what we have. We need to be singing the victory in the streets. We need to be preaching the gospel to the ones that's lost. They don't need to hear about all the church trouble. Yes, I'll be the first to tell you, we got a lot of church trouble because Satan knows we're a real church. If you go somewhere where there ain't no church trouble, probably ain't no church there. Amen. Don't let me play with your mind, because if I'm playing with your mind, then Satan can play with your mind. You should know. I know those that's saying amen tonight is saying it because you're hearing it through the Spirit. You're confirming it through the Spirit. Not because you just know it's real. You know it's the truth. And hopefully those that's watching the same way. Now it goes on to say this. As we're seeing God put together some pieces here. Did not we straightly command you that you should not teach in this name? And behold, ye have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine and intend to bring this man's blood upon us. See, this gives us more understanding of what Peter had begun preaching to them. Last week we spoke just the beginning of that preaching. Remember, he was laying back at them. Look, the very one that was born in Bethlehem, he's the one you crucified. That same one that brought in the miracles and all those things that he did for the sign of being true, you crucified him. So they're bringing that back up. What really hurt them, because at this point there was a lot of people wondering, hey, is this Jesus really real? Which one is real now? Just like the same thing we have in our country, our nation. You notice a lot of people's like really watching what's happening in the politics. They're watching on TV. What's happening on TV? Because they're wondering who is telling the truth. Friends, you shouldn't have to worry who is telling the truth. You should know who's telling the truth if you know the Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit's going to tell you, look, what that preacher's saying is truth. Or what that preacher's saying, he's messed up on. He needs to come in correction. And if you know that it's needing to be corrected, then you come to me out of love and you say, Brother John, I think you need help here. So that's how, see how simple the system is whenever you follow God's system. Let nothing be done without God being the center, it'll be vain glory and all these other things. He said, let it be done in order, not in chaos. So they get asked with this question, did we not tell you not to preach and not to teach and all these things? And then the 29th verse, then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew and hanged on a tree. Him hath God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Jerusalem and forgiveness of sins. And we are his witnesses of these things. And so is also the Holy Ghost, whom God hath given to them that obey him. Now this is important for you to understand. For those that's watching this, you may be watching this as an extra study that we're going to be presenting and putting together for new believers. Okay, what you're going to be going through tonight, we may be using this years from now as a special study for new believers. So I want them to understand, if you're just coming and joining the church, if you've just accepted Jesus Christ, there is a power that only God gives you. It's not a power, something that the pastor gives you. It is a power that only the Holy Spirit gives you. It's not just the power of convicting. Now, you got to realize, Scripture tells us that the Holy Spirit either convicted you or you never was saved. Amen. And you've got to realize, I've seen preachers have unbelievable, evangelists have some unbelievable convicting in-service altar calls that would just draw anybody. Me and Shelley went to one I don't know, a couple years ago, we went to this evangelist. I knew exactly what we was going to get at the end of that service. By the end of that service, everybody that was saved thought they was lost. That's supposed to be funny, but I'm just saying, I'm telling you, everybody's sitting in a pew, buddy, the way he did that altar call, I'm like, man, it was wild, wasn't it? And I told her he's like that. This is how he is, man. He'll get up and he'll get at them. And by the end of that service, if you didn't think he was lost, you better be really thinking. And that's what I want to do, too. I just do it in a different way. But anyway, what I'm saying is, if I get you to this altar, and I had 100 people up here, and boy, they was moved by the message of Jonathan and not moved by the Holy Spirit, then what we have turned out is what we've seen so many times in every single different denominational church. You have false converts, and they didn't really get drawn by the Spirit, and they didn't truly accept Jesus. Yeah. What we want you to do is hear the Holy Spirit convict you. And if you've done that, if you've done seen the Holy Spirit convict your heart, then what else did the Holy Spirit do? That's not the end. That's only the beginning. Look what it says here. I want you to follow close. It says, Him hath God exalted with His right hand to be a prince and a savior. Is Jesus your savior? Have you accepted Jesus as your Lord, as your prince, and as your savior? A lot of people accept Jesus as their savior. I want to be saved from hell. I want to go to heaven. I want to make sure I'm with the rest of the family and we go to heaven. Praise the Lord for that. But do you know Jesus? Well, I don't really know that much about Jesus. Well, we need to step back. We need to make sure you know what Jesus is. Then he goes on, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. You can't come to Jesus, even though you might want to come to Jesus, until you're willing to admit that you're a sinner. You're a bad man and a bad girl who needs Jesus Christ, and you are a sinner in need of saving. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All have sinned. God loved us when we were yet sinners. So have you done that? Have you asked for that forgiveness? Have you asked for that repentance in your life? And then the part that we're really focusing on here today, and we are His witnesses of these things. Let me tell you, church. Remember when I started this off and I told you all the importance of us, no doubt, doing what God has called us to do? I wanted not to just fill up time and content. I wanted God to move the hearts by what He was doing through the Spirit. It's not about the content. Let me tell you something. There's a lot of churches that's died today and many churches that's struggling right now because we got to be the witness. What's everybody talking about in our community? What are they talking about? Give me some ideas because this is back and forth on Wednesday nights. Politics, exactly. That's probably number one. Coronavirus, politics, but that goes back with the politics a lot of times. I mean, it's all about politics. Why? Because apparently politics has influenced you. It's influenced those people. You say, brother, no, it don't influence me. Praise the Lord if it don't. But let me tell you something. I'm going to tell you, politics has influenced a lot of people because politics is running our nation today. Politics. You know who should be influencing those believers out here in Cannon County? It is us as Christians. It's you that are watching this tonight. It should be the influencer of God's Word that's influencing them. You know why we're not as attractive as we once was as a church? Because we're no influence. You say, brother, I wouldn't let that out. Friends, open up your eyes if you don't think it's a secret. The reason these churches ain't full today is because we're not an influence in our community anymore. Why? That goes back to our study tonight. The Holy Spirit has got to be the one who makes you an influence in your community. Made those men bold and those women bold to testify of Jesus Christ. I ain't saying get up on a pew somewhere and start pointing your finger at people. People don't need that. They need the Holy Spirit love and the gospel being preached. They need people who will show that God is changing their life. They need to have people who's willing to show how God has already transformed their being into what they was and to what they are now. That's what they need. Transformation. Transformation. Do what?
That's a good one for the life.
Amen. Amen. That's what I'm saying. Thursday nights is there's so many ways that needs to expand. to help people. That's my little warning, I guess. Yeah, it is. So let's get into the rest of the word. So let me tell you something. Witness is important. And we are his witness of these things. What things? The things in your life. Don't add to God's word. He don't need everybody to be a preacher. He don't need 1,000 teachers in this church. He needs you to do what God has called you to do. And you be a witness. Yeah, you can.
Is it mine?
Yeah. And so be that. Be that witness. The rest of that verse. Look what it says. And so is also the Holy Ghost. How would that be? A witness.
Oh boy.
Hold on there if you're watching at home. Shelly's taking you for a ride a little bit. The Holy Ghost. In the midst of hard times, you're being led by the Holy Ghost. The only way that God can, you got to raise it up.
Is it better?
Yeah, raise it up. Just a little bit more. There we go. Right there. There we go.
A little bit more.
No more.
Right here.
There we go.
Better?
Perfect. And so we have to be a witness, but the Holy Spirit has to be a witness in us. What makes us different? And I'm not wanting people to talk about me. Okay? I don't want people just talking about it. They'll say, Brother John's a good preacher out there. I want people to see the difference in my life. I want them to see the difference in your life. That's the difference. That's how you become an influencer. That's how you'll become a greater witness for the gospel. And what I'm saying is, we got to be that. A lot of young people. We got some new statistics the other day. And believe me, I don't believe in statistics. They can be wrong. We got some new statistics sent to us this other day. Just in this past epidemic of the ratio of people who fell away from the church. And some people look around, they're like, oh man, that's happened here. We've had some that's not with us anymore. Then we have a lot that's not able to be with us because they're doing it remotely. And we have some people that's struggling so much they've had to get other jobs. And this is changing on a weekly basis. I got updates this week, just today, on two of our members that's had to get secondary jobs. I mean, this is hard times, folks. They're still with us. They're watching us online when they can, but it's just what it is. So we keep on growing in God and be a witness, and let the Holy Spirit be a witness in your life. What's going to keep it together? The Holy Spirit power. Which the Holy Spirit power isn't taken away from Jesus, because Jesus is the Holy Spirit. And if Jesus is the Holy Spirit, then Jesus is God. You're not taken away from nothing from the Trinity. It is God Almighty and His plan. Look what it says here. He says, so is also the Holy Ghost, whom God hath given to them that obey Him. The last part of that is so very critical here. It is a reminder for me and you. I mean, the Holy Spirit is for us. But the Holy Spirit can also be grieved. See, this is what hurts so many Christians. Most of their life, it is the Holy Spirit they're grieving, but they're not letting it use their life. Instead of the Holy Spirit being a witness in their life, they're letting the Holy Spirit be grieved in their life. Do you know you can grieve the Holy Spirit? Grieve the Holy Spirit? You know what grief means? Everybody ever grieved in here? I have. Anybody ever hurt? How can we possibly hurt the Lord? We was going through this study today, and Shelly was the one that looked at me, and she said, that is so confusing. How can we grieve the Holy Spirit? And I said, you know, it's wild. And she just sort of, she sometimes says the things that needs to be said to the preacher, because I just overrun it. And I'm like, you know, I don't know. I don't know. Let's talk about that. And so we talk more about it. And when we think about grieving, we're talking about hurting the Holy Spirit. How could you, a mortal person, hurt something that is spiritual like that? Because that's how close the Holy Spirit is with you. That's how close the Holy Spirit is with your testimony, your direction, trying to keep you on the right track, trying to show you the right track, trying to let you feel those other spirits that should be contrary to the Holy Spirit. There's a lot the Holy Ghost does. And one of those things is we don't want to grieve the Holy Spirit. We want to make sure that we obey God's word, which is obeying Him that was sent. God sent that Holy Spirit so we would obey Him. Look in the next verse, 33rd verse. When they heard that, and were cut to their hearts and took counsel to slay them. Let me tell you something. When you start preaching the gospel as a church, you're going to have somebody that Satan will send after you because they ain't going to like the message. Same thing's going to happen right here. So be it. Satan has no power because Jesus is the power. Jesus has the power and dominance of everything, and Satan has no place. Amen. Because when you preach the truth like Peter did, buddy, they was cut. What was it? They were cut to their heart. If you ain't got no better preaching than they ain't cutting to the heart, I don't know what you're doing. I want to preach the message that cuts to your heart. You're gonna feel the messages on your toes, but if all I'm doing is jumping on your toes, then I ain't doing my job. If I ain't doing the message to cut to your heart, then I ain't doing my job as a pastor. He says, and took counsel to slay them, then stood up one in the council, a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a doctor of the law, had in reputation among all the people, and commanded to put the apostles forth a little space, and said unto them, ye men of Israel, take heed to yourselves that ye intend to do as touching these men. For before these days rose up the Theudas, boasting himself to be a somebody, to whom a number of men, about 400, joined themselves, who was slain, and all as many as obeyed him were scattered and brought to naught. Now this one Pharisee that is in their story right now sort of brought this situation. He said, slow down. He wanted to give some thoughts to this. And he said, there was this Theudas that was boasting. Boasting himself. It was all about him. He was a antichrist, or he was a false Christ. And they did the same thing to him, what they're fixing to do to Peter and them. And the followers, all of his disciples, basically just scattered and were dispersed. After this man rose up, Judas of Galilee, in the days of taxing, drew away much people after him. He also perished, and all, even as many as obeyed him, were dispersed. And now I say unto you, refrain from these men and let them alone. For if this counsel or this work be of men, it will come to naught. But if it be of God, ye cannot overthrow it, lest happily ye be found even to fight against God. And let me tell you something. This one counsel that we're looking at, this one guy, Gamaliel, he had some understanding, didn't he? He says that you can't come against God. Brother John, what are we going to do in the midst of this pandemic? We're going to do what God tells us to do, and God's going to take care of us. He's took care of the fishes. He's took care of all the... He's always took care of me. He's going to take care of us. If we lose our job, He'll give us something else so we can eat and feed our families. If we lose our lives, I'm just going to have victory. If the government tries to shut down the church, we're going to keep on preaching until they take the last one of us out. And if they take us out, that's just going to make me more excited because I'm going to get to go home. You can't scare me. You can't do nothing to me but give me victory. If you take my life, that's the only thing you can do. God can take life and soul. Remember what we read last week? Praise God. It's just exciting. What this means is we need to be praying for our fellow man. We need to be praying for all those who are being affected. And let me tell you something. My family was even affected by the coronavirus. It's affecting everybody. We're in the midst of judgment. Understand that we're in the midst of judgment and keep on pressing on. But let me tell you something. If we're the real thing, then there ain't nothing going to shut down this church unless it's God. Did you hear me? Can I get some amens for that? Amen. The pandemic is not going to shut us down if we've been doing what God's called us to do. And the pandemic won't shut us down. R2 or whatever else they're calling the second one coming on. Here we go again. Friends, you need to realize this may be just the way it is. One virus after another. I don't care. We got to keep preaching the gospel for the ones that's still here, because there's a lot of souls that could die of the coronavirus that needs to know Jesus.
Amen.
Okay? Praise the Lord. All right, let's try to sum this up. I want to take our prayer time. So here's what it says. In the midst of all this, but if God be, if in 39th verse, let's repeat that for anybody that's watching. But if it be of God, ye cannot overthrow it, lest haply ye be found even to fight against God. And to him they agreed, and when they had called the apostles and beaten them, they commanded that they should not speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. Now there was, they needed to get a little out just to make them feel better about themselves, so they beat the apostles up. And then they let them go. And they departed from the presence of the council. I'm proud for this one that God had in place. See, God knew what he was doing. He used this one Pharisee to stop them from slaying them. But they were so mad at this point, they wanted to slay him. In the next chapter, the first deacon, Stephen, he would die at their hands. And once again, his testimony, the last words that he had speak, he didn't get far. He started in the very beginning of the whole thing with Abraham and the faith that Abraham had. He preached all the way. He only got a little bit past Moses, and then they had to kill him because they couldn't hear no more. We'll get into that message hopefully next week. You see how Satan is. He cannot stand the truth. And the only thing protecting me, because there's so many demons that would like to take me down right now, is by God's presence and his power. Amen. The only reason you survived getting your trip here is by God's power and his presence of his Holy Spirit. I'll be honest with you. It would scare us half to death, half of us. It may actually encourage some of us if we were able to see half of what's around us. There's a reason why God doesn't allow that. Because he wants it by faith. He could show you a bunch of scenes and make you see ghosts and demons and everything else, but unless you're drawn by your heart, it ain't worth 2 cents. I'll be honest with you. He didn't want to send this judgment on our world, but he's had to do it because people just would not listen, and they just kept on doing it. They're going to live on, live on. 2020 is going to be like every other year, wasn't it? Not now. We'll just leave the rest up to God. I'm not going to say more about 2021. Here's what I'm going to do. Regardless of what year it is, I'm going to do what he's told me to do. Amen. Prepare yourselves. Be ready. So activate. Where does this, our whole lesson in learning in this series is to activate. I hope that you realize some of the key things that I've even put on our main pages, our YouTube channel and stuff, is to activate God's presence in our life. And to activate God's presence means to activate the Spirit. Activate the Spirit. So, 41st verse, and they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. And daily in the temple and in every house, they ceased not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. In every house, they ceased not to teach and preach. Let's do the same thing today. While we still have the opportunity, let's cease not to preach. And remember the testimony of the Holy Spirit in your life. Now prayer request or questions before we dismiss. Miss Reed, if you would, make sure you tell me if anybody shares a prayer request. For those that's watching, if you want to share a prayer request. Anybody got a prayer request before we go, Lord, in prayer? Yes.
Sinus infection and trying to treat it myself.
Yes.
I let it get into my lungs.
Yes.
And that's why I hadn't been back in such a long time. But God took care of me. Y'all's prayers helped tremendously. And I really, really appreciate all.
Amen. We love you, Miss Elvira. Praise the Lord for her being back. Amen.
Amen.
And her family. Let's continue to pray for her family. And no, she was tested for corona. This is just one of those times where she had a major sinus infection. Then it got down into your lungs and everything else. So praise the Lord for what he's doing. Anybody else?
I have some requests also, please. My brother, as y'all know, had a stroke a few months ago. Now he has the virus. And they had him in the hospital for 5 days, I believe it was. And now he's back in the nursing home. And His son is trying to get him transferred to Indianapolis, where his home is. But they're having trouble with all that. They need your prayers. Amen. My brother needs your prayers to come out of this.
Yes, yes. Let's pray for her brother.
And also, I found out today that Gallatin Jail is full of the coronavirus. I'm sure it's not the only one. But that's where my grandson is.
Okay, okay.
And he's been exposed quite a bit.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So please remember him.
Okay. Let's remember her grandson. Let's remember Brother Jim Sartan's brother. His name's Russell, and you know, we've been praying for him for weeks. You know, he's been on hospice care. They didn't expect him to leave the hospital. He's left the hospital. He's back. The latest thing that I heard from Jim was he even has been setting up. He's got to go back into his study. That's just a miracle. Yeah. Praise the Lord. I mean, however many days the Lord's given, that's a testimony. So I promised God that I would testify and praise God for his healing. And whatever God's doing, let's just praise God for what he's doing. Amen. Amen. It's in Jesus' name the reason Russell's still alive and he's able to preach and he's able to sit in his own study. That is Jesus Christ and his power.
Miracles do happen.
A miracle is happening in our presence. And we've seen a miracle right here. You'd have been dumb and gone if it hadn't been for God to touch you. It didn't take, praise the Lord, it didn't take no elders coming to your house. It was by God's presence. Even though God uses us still, let's not be lazy, elders. He still uses us for prayers. He uses the ladies for prayers. But praise God for that. Anybody else?
Jonathan, remember Brother Bob lost his house?
Yes. Awful to hear that. Some of y'all heard about Brother Bob losing his house. No, lost a lot of his stuff. So let's remember his whole family. Anybody else?
They're having a spaghetti dinner at their church, Seventh-day Adventist Church, this Saturday night.
Okay.
As a fundraiser.
I saw Miss Christine, I think, was trying to share that, and I'll try to get that shared also. This Saturday night at the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Is that right? Yes. So anybody that can go support that, let's support that. Okay.
Just a
drive-thru, that's good. What time does that start?
5:00.
5:00.
Okay. He said he didn't know Cannon County had so many good people. But they have been pretty good to
them. That's good. That's good. Anybody else? Miss Linda?
Pray for my son, Mark.
Brother Mark, we'll pray for him. Miss Linda?
I have a very precious friend to me that is a nurse who has taken such good care of her mom and daddy over the years. And she lost both of them to COVID this week. They're going to bury her mama and her dad tomorrow.
Okay.
And I lost mine 2 years apart. Yeah. And it was devastating to me. I cannot imagine.
I can't either.
Them having to do a funeral with her mama and her daddy. Fine Christian people. I don't worry about that part.
Yeah.
But we have lost so many of our elderly.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
Not just
that's right.
COVID has played havoc with a lot of our older people,
yeah.
Especially.
It's just like, you know this, the healthcare system is at its weakest point, but not because of the people, they're just wore out. We witnessed this a couple weeks ago. This was during after Thanksgiving. You know, they were reporting from Nashville that a woman was begging for help in one of the emergency rooms in St. Thomas West, and she died of a heart attack in their emergency room before she even made it inside. That's how backed up they are. That's why it's, friends, let's pray for each other. It's just this. Well, we've got a niece. She's in healthcare. She is in her 20s, and she's been out a week because she's wore out. They're working these people nonstop.
She's a manager at the nurse's.
She's at the nursing home. She's just wore out. She's in her 20s. I'm just telling you.
The personal protective equipment that is required from EMS, lab, x-ray, housekeeping, if you have any contact with the patient, I'm going to tell you, the masks are hard enough to breathe through, but you start putting N95s on people.
Yeah.
And they're rough. Lynn's over there shaking his head. They are rough to breathe through for 12 hours at a time.
Yeah. Rough to breathe through for 10 minutes. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
They were designed to keep us from getting tuberculosis.
Yeah.
Which was the respiratory disease that we were all worried about in the 60s, 70s, and even into the 80s. And that was what those masks were designed for, is to prevent us from getting tuberculosis. Mm-hmm. And that is the mask. When I tested positive, the first thing they did was hand me an N95 and say, put this on.
Yeah.
You can't go anywhere, can't go to the bathroom, can't do anything, sit right there.
That's right.
Don't move.
That's right. Miss Christine said, pray for our hero health care and public servants. That's exactly right.
And some other ones too.
All right. Miss Reeve, if you'll help me with those.
Christopher Brewington, prayers for my test to be negative. Jimmy Hayes.
Let's remember Brother Jimmy.
Wesley Beck, I pray for my best friend.
Okay.
The
virus. Wesley Beck, remembering his best friend.
James Hartman, his brother Russell.
Yes.
Johnny.
Okay. Let's all stand.
There was another one that Tammy had on there about somebody.
Miss Tammy, you got one.
There you go.
Yeah. Friends of Charlie, Greg Arnold, he passed away with COVID complications in his family.
Okay. Okay. Let's remember each other. All right. Don't forget, just a reminder before we go, Lord, in prayer, we got communion this Sunday. You know, we're wanting to keep everybody as safe as possible. So this Sunday we will have our transmitter outside so you can hear our service in the parking lot. Or you can watch online wherever you're at, and you can come by from 10 to 10:30 to pick up our little communion. You won't spill them in your car unless you open them in your car. They're sealed off so you can come. They got the bread and the grape juice all right there in one. It's not about what we're doing. If it's just a symbol, it's not worth 2 cents. But it's about taking this time to remember what we are together. We are the church. And during, we have done several communions since this pandemic. Each time that we do one, it is even more special to me because the communion is us joining. What joins us together in unity is his body, his blood, so that he could join us together through our spirit, which is one spirit, the Holy Spirit. It's very important that we do that today as the church. So may God bless y'all. We're going to close in prayer and then we'll be dismissed. Come see us Sunday or see us online. And don't forget our Sunday schools at 9:30. Let's bow our heads. Brother Ron Moore, if you would lead us in prayer.
Our precious Heavenly Father, we do thank you, Lord, for all that you do for each one of us,
yes,
each and every day. Thank you for the many blessings that you give us that go without thanks. But Lord, we just ask your presence of the Holy Spirit in each member of this church family.
Yes.
I pray, Father, that you would just see an uprising of your will,
yes,
done in our lives. Help us all to be better promoters and teachers. And just ask you, Father, just to please forgive us where we fail. Pray that you would just continue to work in our lives and work in this church and continue the truth being preached here. We just thank you and love you and just ask for your forgiveness. In Jesus' name.
I know, I heard.
Because I stood up for her.
Yeah. Well, hey, it's worth it. There you go. Okay. Surprising. Sister, love you.
Thank you. Love you too.
Love you. Y'all be careful. Stay safe out there, okay?